issue. Yeah, so for smart seed, basically using this machine, we're able to sort the cells into single cell little wells, and within each well you add a reagent, you make the transcript, and that hopefully will amplify evenly. Then you can put that onto a high throughput sequencing machine. The second part, so this part is you buy the reagent and you do this in your own lab. DropSeq has a specific machine that can do this. 10x Genomics has a pretty good machine here. So the idea is, you can see here, on this side, they have little droplets of oil. And then the single cells are coming in, and if they happen to meet, the cell will somehow go into the droplet, and then this will go through. And so in this channel, there are like little droplets keep going, and most of these droplets are actually empty. Occasionally, there would be one droplet that has a cell that happened to drop in. Okay, and then the reagent, and then you have, it's like a, you can imagine you have a beaker, but it's really a small tube, okay? You have a beaker of many oil droplets, and some of these oil droplets are empty inside, but some of them has a little cell, one cell in there. Occasionally, it makes a mistake, there are two cells in that droplet, but you are hoping that the cell comes in slowly enough that you will mostly be one cell in, no more than one cell in the droplet for most of the wells. And then you have this whole tube, all the cells will go through the reagent. So the reagent comes in the oil droplet. Okay, and so when you just need to heat up the tube, you know, like add different, like to make things happen, they happen in parallel in the droplets, in each droplet. So all the cells within, each cell within each droplet will independently amplify its RNA. And so on this one, you can see here, there are, you know, when you do the PCR, you also get the poly A transcript is poly T, but in addition to the poly T, there are other barcodes in here. One is called the UMI, the other is called is called barcode. I'll show you how this works later. Okay. Well, I can tell you now. First, the barcode tells us what cell it is. Okay, so each droplet will have a different barcode going in. So they will have they will know if the barcode is different, it's coming from a different droplet, a different cell. The second called the UMI is to make sure that when you PCR amplification, you don't amplify the same thing over and over again too much, that it's no longer kind of a linear amplification, okay? So you want to make sure that it's coming from that one transcript, you only count it once. And so again, somehow they always add this GGG at the end. I guess that helps the amplification better. And so all the transcripts, you hope most of the transcripts will be amplified. And then all these transcripts will have the UMI and the barcode at the end of this RNA. And then you send it for sequencing. So this one is kind of explaining the DropSeq in better detail. You can see the cells are coming in and the oils are also coming in. And somehow, because this, I see. So the droplet is like this. And at this point, if there's a little squirt, you know, the air, I guess they push air on the top and bottom, so they will be squeezed in. Okay? So this is each droplet. I guess they push the water, actually, to stop this. And this one has a little particle. Yeah, so this one has a little, so this one is actually the oil, and this one is the reagent that comes in a little particle. So all the reagent is attached to this little bead, okay? And so within each oil particle, all this reaction happening in parallel. So first you open up the cell, so the RNA will all spill out. And then with this, so because the particle has the poly T, it will enrich for RNAs that have the poly A onto it. And then six, or you can say six or eight base. Eight base, it's just whatever randomly. You have all sorts of different collections, okay? But within this barcode, within this little particle, all of the sequences attached to it will have the same barcode to say this is barcode, is particle one or droplet one or droplet two, okay? And then you go to this, next step is, okay. You use this to attach the T to the different ends, and so now the mRNA of the original cell is attached to the bead. Okay, now I know. Then you break the droplet, now they all open up. And so the different barcodes are mixed together, but each transcript is attached to, all the transcript for the cell is attached to the bead with the same barcode. And then when you prepare your samples, you can see this is that kind of the transcript for one bead or one particle. And then there are different transcripts. You can have your reaction for RT-PCR, you know, like amplify this region. And then they will make into these sequencing libraries. Okay? And so all of the RNA for this is in this particle. And all of the transcript for the another cell is on another particle. And you cleave them off from the particle, then you do the high throughput sequencing. Okay? So there are many variations to this reaction. The first is a cDNA conversion rate. So when you have an RNA, you try to make a cDNA. That step, some of them just don't make it, or most of them don't make it actually. The droplet size.
What does C stand for? cDNA.
Complementary. Because originally it was your RNA, the first DNA you made based on the RNA transcript is the complementary to your actual RNA. Okay. The droplet size, if your droplet is too big, there could be two cells or two barcodes in there, then it's not very good. Reagent concentration, so these are what this Drop-C company does. They really tune this well, the concentration is right. So in some sense, the rate of this going in and the rate of the cell going in, it needs to be very well synchronized so that it's one particle with one cell, one particle with one cell. Although you can see here, there are some that's just empty droplet. There are also occasionally empty cells and also empty particles. And so these ones will not make it. Only these ones are the effective ones. And you can see the effective ones is the minority. Except that when you do PCR amplification, the other ones never, well, not never, but they rarely add to the noise. Okay? And your PCR efficiency, this is pretty important too, like, because you have to amplify your RNA, like, or the cDNA like crazy. And so the UMI controls over amplification of one transcript. If initially you have just one RNA and you amplify it like crazy, at the end, all of the things you sequence will have the same UMI. You will know that it's not 50, it's just one, because they came from one at the beginning. Okay? So you can see, you know, if you have cell one and cell two, they are expressing different amount of this purple and blue, and you might get there like four genes in here. It's the blue, purple, black, and the gray, and in the two cells there are some differences. And so first you do the reverse transcription, barcoding, and UMI labeling, right? So this happens in the droplet. And so you can see they all are attached to different things, right? There are some RNAs that are lost, and also some RNAs just never get it, like never made it into the cDNA. But after this, you can mix them together, to do the PCR amplification and to do the sequencing. But after that, you can do the deconvolution because. So this is the situation. For single cell sequencing, especially drop-seq, you always sequence paired end. like you use a poly T. And so you can barcode the UMI and a whole bunch of T's. And then it's the other end that gives you the actual transcript that allow you to do the mapping to the reference genome. Okay? And so how do we do this? We say if they have different barcode, they are coming from different cells. And so the first thing you do is you align, so you first separate the reads by their barcode. If they are same barcode, so this cell barcode, they're coming from the same cell. And then you use this other end to map to the reference genome to for that particular gene. Okay? And the second thing is, sometimes you will see it's the same gene, like this guy. It's the same gene, even though this sequence is, so if the RNA is the same, and also the barcode is, the barcode is the same, you know they come from the same cell, but if the UMI is also the same, it would mean that they actually came from originally that single starting template. And so anything that are coming from the same cell with the same UMI, you only count it once. In order to count this transcript multiple times, they have to have different UMI. Okay, then you can say that's a really multiple transcript. And so at the end, you get this matrix again. This is similar to the AFI matrix. You have every gene, you have every cell, and you count for this gene, how many transcripts or like reads do I have that have the same barcode but different UMI that map to this location. That's the real thing. Okay? Questions?
Yes. What is UMI?
So you can see, so sometimes you have the same initial RNA, mRNA, and then you make the T, and you amplify it, you make the cDNA. And this one comes with the UMI and the cell barcode, okay? But if this gets amplified next time, you make it to a cDNA, you amplify it, it will be 2, 4, 8, 16, whatever, just kind of exponential increase. For these increases, we don't want to count it 16 times. If this gene is really expressed a lot, we want another RNA from the same gene that has a different UMI to again make the cDNA.
Well, I just forgot what UMI is. That's why.
Oh, because as you amplify, all of them will have the same UMI. For the, this is just one initial template.
What is UMI? My question.
UMI is a random sequence.
UMI is random sequence.
It's a random 12-mer sequence, right? It's a random 12-mer, but if it gets attached to this transcript, as this transcript amplify.
Sorry, UMI stands for random 12-mer?
You need a molecular identifier.
Okay.
Unique molecular identifier.
Okay.
So it's like an ID for this mRNA in the original solution.
Okay.
So as you amplify more, you don't want them to all add up as the expression level of this, because you know this was just one. And you want this gene, so because when this gene is expressed a lot, it's not just one mRNA, it's multiple mRNA. You want the multiple mRNA each to attach to this UMI, in a different UMI. Then if you read more different UMI for this gene, that's the real thing, that's the real transcript. Okay? If they all have the same UMI, then it started from the a single transcript in the very beginning. Then that's just amplification bias.
Yeah.
Because for some reason some sequence just amplify better than others.
It's still classic.
Yeah. Okay? So now you get this matrix. Can you guess what are most of the numbers on this matrix? you sequence a lot, most of these are going to be zeros. Yeah, so let's look at the difference, okay? So SMRT-based and the droplet-based, they both take fresh cells. SMRT-seq, you do this one cell at a time. And droplet-based, you put all the droplets together. It's kind of like oil drops in a tube. You can do like 10,000 or like 100,000 cells in one tube. Okay? And so this one, usually you do this for small cell population. So imagine you care about some specific embryo development. You need to make sure you really capture the cell. You don't want to lose it, right? You only have like 3 cells at this, or 5 cells in this embryonic stage. You want to really capture it. For droplet based, because it's like, there's actually a lot of loss. A lot of cells just didn't make it. And so if you only have for like 200 cells, you don't want to do a dropseq. You need to have, I think, in the order of tens of thousands of cells to start with before you can do a dropseq experiment. Otherwise, they all drop out. You just don't see enough cells. Okay? Yeah, so it's a higher dropout of the cells. The SMRT-seq is like one at a time. You can make it go much, much slower to make sure when the flow cytometry see this going in, it actually drop in the well. So usually it's a lower dropout on the cell level. So for the droplet base, you need a cell barcode. A SMRT base, you also need a cell barcode because you can prepare the library separately, but at the end when you sequence, you still mix them together to form a lane of sequencing. And the cell barcode will tell you this is well one, well two, well three, you know, of your original reagent, of your original cell collection. Whereas, so this one, in addition to the cell barcode, you have a UMI for adjusting for PCR bias. I think actually for SMRT-seq, because these reagents continue to change, this UMI is not a bad idea. UMI is like you have an internal control. If you see something good, do you see it repeatedly in many different UMIs? That's kind of an internal replicate, right? And people are trying to add UMI to a lot of other experiments now. So there's a UMI. A SMRT-seq, because you do it one well at a time, you can actually get a full-length transcript better, but you only get like usually like 96 well plates or a few hundred cells. The droplet-based method have a 3' bias. You use the poly-T to because they all use this poly-T to get the end of the transcript. You can't reach the other end. Then everything is mixed together in this big pot. Right? So all the transcripts you can sequence are towards the 3' end. And transcript per cell, how many different genes or how many transcripts different type of RNA can you see? For droplet-based, I think now the standard is about 2,000 to 4,000 genes that you can actually get a number. So in the matrix for this cell, usually 2 to 4,000 rows will have a number. The rest, 18,000 or 16,000, are all zeros. You just didn't see anything. For SMRT-seq, I think you can see a little bit more. I actually don't know how many. Like, these numbers are continuing to improve, probably like 5 or 7,000 genes. And also these techniques are being improve. So per cell, you do see more transcription. The transcript per cell is much, much lower. Also, for cluster, I'll talk about the cluster a little later. Like, because you have, usually for dropseq, you can do thousands of cells together. And after that, we could cluster the cells together, say, roughly this is in a tumor. These are the T cells, these are the cancer cells, and these are the some normal stroma cells, right? And even though the expression level for a single cell is pretty bad, you probably don't want to read out the expression level from that single cell, but if you say, they are pretty similar, you can average a few hundred cells together, to get that expression read up. And that's actually pretty good. It's even more accurate than this like SmartSeq one cell at a time. Okay? And of course, they are all very expensive. It's just, you know, the more cells you have, the more you have to sequence. And also these reagents are expensive. Per cell is very cheap, like a few cents per cell. Like you do a few thousand cells, and also you buy the reagent. These reagents, like if it, oh, you were testing, $10,000 gone. You haven't even started sequencing yet. Didn't make a library, too bad. So it does take some experiments to make it working. And so depending on what you are doing, like if you just care about that one, a few cells in a developmental stage for some transition, you might want to use SmartSeq. But if you just kind of have a piece of tissue, I want to roughly see where things are, you can use droplet. Okay? So the potential applications. You can use it to understand stem cell differentiation, right? You see a stem cell, you treat the cell with some condition. You can do this in petri dish as well, or you can do this in a real embryo. You can look at the state transition as the cell develop or differentiate. You can map the heterogeneity in the complex tissue types, like a tumor, like in your brain, or blood. Within each, it has a lot of different things. You can also use it to identify new type of cells. You say, oh, you know, I thought it has this thing. It turns out that people are finding this now. You look at some tumors and you say, oh, there is a new type of T cell. It has a little bit of signature like this, but it also has a signature of that, and people didn't know this type of cell exists. It's like, between bird and dinosaur, they found this new thing that has, you know, feathers and also claws, right? So things like that. You can find those new things, new cell types. And also sometimes you can use it to look at stochastic and dynamic response to perturbation. For example, you can say, you know, initially the tumor looked like this. Maybe I treat the mice with some drug, and then you look at the tumor, it can reduce the variability of the cells. Like if you look at just the cancer cells on some gene expression, you can see the genes between the cells actually vary a lot, but then maybe after a drug treatment, they will be more homogeneous.